So today's video is going to be a little bit different. It's going to be shorter because I want people to watch this all the way through. Today's topic is very important to understand before we try to delve into making systemic change, which is what this channel is about. Society is in a bad place. And while there are many things that we need to change, I think we often overlook a very important change that needs to happen before any of the other changes can hold any weight. We need to fix democracy. What does democracy mean to you? At its most basic root, it means rule by the people. Abraham Lincoln defined it as government of the people, by the people, for the people. And Webster defines it as a government in which the supreme power is vested in the people and exercised by them directly or indirectly through a system of representation, usually involving periodically held free elections. So why do we allow our governments to be run the way they are while still claiming to be democratic? The most important thing that needs to be made abundantly clear is that the government isn't some high society separate class. They are people selected to serve the people. They work for you. Or at least they should. When the colonial powers departed the Caribbean, they left in their place political institutions based on the Westminster model of government. These structures were not about ensuring independence, they were about preserving the status quo, where government systems were based on strict exclusionary practices, such as crown colony government or the old representative system. Consequently, important decisions were left up to an elite few, and the voice of the people was ignored in political discourse. I mean, what do you expect when, in order to hold the office of Governor General or Prime Minister or even a minister or any job throughout government, you have to take an oath to be faithful and bear true allegiance to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, her heirs and successors? It's indoctrination and it was successful. In an essay on the myth of independence, Jamaican political scientist Lewis Lindsay quoted from a speech delivered by then Premier Norman Manley 5 months before Jamaica's independence. Mr. Manley declared that the British Constitution is the best in the world, the only good system of government. He continued, "I make no apology for the fact that we did not attempt to embark upon an original or novel exercise in constitutional building. I am not ashamed of any institution which exists in this country merely because it derives from England." Over in Trinidad and Tobago, Prime Minister Eric Williams, a harsh critic of colonialism, capitalism, and slavery, was also declaring, "If the parliament system is good enough for England, it is good enough for us." Compare these views from these Caribbean leaders to that of Patrice Lumumba, speaking at the independence of Congo 2 years earlier in the presence of the Belgian king. Although this independence of the Congo is being proclaimed today by agreement with Belgium, an amicable country with which we are on equal terms, no Congolese will ever forget that independence was won in struggle, a persevering and inspired struggle carried on from day to day, a struggle in which we were undaunted by privation or suffering and stinted neither strength nor blood. It was filled with tears, fire, and blood. We are deeply proud of our struggle because it was just and noble and indispensable in putting an end to the humiliating bondage forced upon us. That was our lot for 80 years of colonial rule, and our wounds are too fresh and much too painful to be forgotten. So here in the Caribbean, our relationship with government has been messed up from the start, but it doesn't have to be. Even in Britain, the Westminster model evolved over time, while here our rate of evolution seems to be very, very slow. What is most important is to rebuild the fundamentals of democracy. If our Caribbean political systems are to be considered democratic, then the voice of the people must play an active role in the decisions made by the leadership. Good governance, therefore, requires a symbiotic, well-functioning relationship between those who hold office and the citizens. This kind of government is categorized by transparency, accountability, and the effective and efficient management of public funds. It places the national interest at the center of all decision making. People who misuse public office for their aggrandizement must be held accountable for their actions or inactions. In Dominica, after some research, I found that there was no body outside of the police force, which is just the enforcement arm of the state, that can investigate the criminal activity of those within government. This has to be fixed. Anti-corruption agencies must be equipped with the proper systems and personnel to investigate and prosecute public officers who abuse their position. In the Caribbean, it is important that systems are put into place and that the culture changes to encourage whistleblowing and the reporting of individuals who act unethically while holding public office. In the 21st century, where we can observe and borrow from political systems all throughout the world, there is no reason that a modern society should be operating under these archaic systems that don't work. A good example of democratic improvement is Batopili in South Africa. Batopili literally means people first and is founded on 8 fundamental principles: consultation, service standards, access, courtesy, information, openness and transparency, redress and value for money. Each of these principles highlights the importance of a participatory relationship between the government and its people. The principles speak to the value of engagement through consultancy and integrity through openness and transparency, two central features of public engagement. But we don't need to look so far to inspire a more citizen-centered government. We have to make use of tried and true methods for voicing opinions. Petitions. We all know how petitions work. We should have a system by which if a petition gains a certain amount of support, it has to be heard by the government. It shouldn't be a case where we're gonna try to get some signatures and see if we can get it heard. The means for people to get their voice heard must be well established and upheld. We need to have a proper system of town halls and village council meetings. When your parliamentary representative goes to the house, how can he be representing you when there's never been any interaction with the public? We need mandatory and frequent village council meetings. Here's an analogy. If the country had 20 people, everybody would go to parliament and represent their own interests. But that can't happen on the scale of an entire population. But that same concept of everybody's interests being represented is what representatives are for. So we have to embrace policy that works towards the goal of everybody being represented and oppose systems that seek to move away from that. Anyway, I started this video trying to keep it short, but it seems like it's as long as any other video. These are just some suggestions to get the discussion started. Let me know how you think we can improve democracy in the comments. If you like this video, be sure to like, subscribe, share it, and follow me on Instagram wherever you see this. And see you next week.